Hi, guys.
Okay.
Yes, you have the clicker. Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is Arabi. This is my partner, Ahmed. And we're here with Pili, talking about our new prescription delivery service here in Toronto. So we've all been here before, standing in line at the pharmacy, waiting for your medication to be processed. The average wait time today is over 30 minutes, and that's not including the time it takes to go to and from the pharmacy. Meanwhile, you're picking up Doritos and Diet Cokes and filling up your basket with, you know, random products. So, you know, the experience is so bad today that of all the prescriptions out there, 30% of them remain unfilled. And we know that there's a great percentage of customers out there who are open to using, you know, mobile alternatives to, you know, managing their health. So when we looked at all these stats, we said, you know what, there's got to be a better way to do this. So we looked at the industry. No surprise, pharma is a big business. $1 billion is spent on dispensing fees annually. And we look specifically at our target market, and we think that's millennials, busy professionals, and young families. And specifically within the Toronto area, that's worth about $100 million. So big opportunity. So we created a new mobile experience that's simple, fast, and best of all, it's free. And it really starts with the customer. On their smartphone, they have a prescription in hand, and they take a photo of their prescription, and they choose when and where they want their medication to be delivered. That process end-to-end takes about 30 seconds, so really quick. 30 minutes later, one of our pharmacists will call the customer to provide consultation on their medication. And later that day, the customer will receive their medication at their doorstep, whether it's at home or their workplace. So really, from a customer experience perspective, they have a pharmacy in their pocket, a couple of clicks of a button, and they have their medication delivered to them absolutely free. So we are live today, pili.ca, taking orders. If you so happen to have a prescription on you right now, you can actually submit an order, and we'll show up at your doorstep later today with your medication.
So I think one of the things that we really want to get across is there's obviously a lot of people in the space most recently. And the areas that, like, the approach that we took was really about, we started with a very basic concept of just delivering convenience around delivery. But as we learned more about the business and we got another partner who's actually a pharmacist, we started to understand that to really create an ideal and unique mobile experience, you need to think about the pharmacy and integrate deep with the pharmacy. And that's really what our business is, how we differentiate ourselves, is that we have a pharmacy partner and we work very closely with them to create a hub that really looks at delivering across the city. And so the things that we changed to create a mobile experience, one that delivers interaction with you and is easy and where pharmacists are accessible, we had to change a few things. And so one of the key ones is really about having a central patient profile. So similar to, like, you know, when you do any e-commerce site or you're shopping for whatever, there's clear outlines about what your history is, what your communication preferences are. And I think one thing that was really telling is a lot of pharmacies actually don't even have their patients' emails. So being able to have that is really key to our business. Another area that we focused on was, you know, with our model, pharmacists focus on the two things that they want to do and are trained to do, which is deliver accurate medication and talk to patients about their health needs. You know, not worried about, spills on aisles or people not sure what the price of a can of Coke is or whatever. Another kind of centralization brings us to other key things, which is about inventory management. So having one central hub where you have all your prescriptions, you can easily forecast the inventory, make changes on the fly, and do it in an efficient way. And then finally, there's obviously clear delivery efficiencies that come when you have pre-planned kind of central location. All this means is that we're not tied to a location, like current pharmacy is landlocked based on who's around and who goes there. We're able to kind of expand beyond that and deliver some really clear things that are core to us. So beyond just the convenience, it's about access to the pharmacist. You can chat, text, call them whenever you like. There's flexible delivery times and locations. So, you know, today it's not just I picked it up, you know, at home in my neighborhood. Next time I need a refill, we can deliver it to you at work. And then just having auto refills and things like transfers, they're all seamless. It's a quick message to the pharmacist to take care and provide any extra information you need. So, yeah, Pili and chill, that was one of our customer quotes, so we want to include that. So to give you a little background around pharmacy and how it works, every prescription has kind of three parts to it. So the first one is the dispensing fee. The second one is 8% markup on the cost of the drugs. And the last part is like drug company rebates that come back at the end based on volume targets. So when you work with a large large pharmacy, they have that going for them. So just, I know I'm running out of time, but just really quickly, today our model is we focus on the dispensing fee. We take 100% of that, reallocate that to cover delivery. And then we're making $5 profit per prescription. And in areas where you order one or more prescriptions, we're still paying the same delivery fee, but obviously making all additional dispensing fee revenue. And that's how we grow and incorporate new services, so that one phone call kind of brings on more services. So I'll leave it there. We have a couple more slides that maybe are, all right. At the time? Okay, is there any questions? Maybe we'll answer them and then we could use the slides to help.
Who does the deliveries?
So a lot of pharmacies today do delivery, and they use, there's basically couriers that can handle delivery for you. So we have a pretty strong relationship with a courier company that handles those deliveries. And part of that means they go drop it to your house, pick up the physical prescription when they deliver the medicine, and bring it back to the pharmacy.
Does the audience have any questions? Yeah? Okay. We'll just pass it. No, I need this for the live stream. I'm sorry.
So what about the risk of someone stealing the drugs? Like, what happens if the courier just runs off with all these drugs that were not meant for them?
So we don't use, any person who just walked off the street. We use companies that have a history of providing pharmaceuticals. Like, a lot of elderly people will get prescription delivery. These are insured, bonded companies. So we're covered as much as any traditional model is. And we haven't been robbed yet, so.
Hi. Can you talk about if there's any regulation regarding the 8% markup of drugs?
Yeah, 8% markup is standard fees. That's what everybody, that's kind of the mandated amount. Every pharmacy makes dispensing fee, which has a variable amount. And then they also, that's their bread and butter. They're guaranteed 8% on the cost of the drugs. So that's standard.
We're coming.
Yeah, in the back.
Just with the, please hold your question.
Yeah, no problem.
What about prescriptions that require a physical prescription as such, like narcotics, which is 30% of all prescriptions? Pharmacies will not be allowed to dispense unless they have the actual physical paper. What do you do for that?
So narcotics is an interesting one. I think we typically don't deliver narcotics. The rule of thumb for us has been we only look at a narcotic prescription if there's a couple things that have to be there. So one is that our pharmacist is in the area and will deliver that. We haven't seen that 30% number. It's been a lot lower for at least the customers that we've been exposed to. So generally speaking, with narcotics too, there's a bunch of regulations and things that you have to do. So there is a central system today that every pharmacist uses to register a narcotic prescription and make sure that it's not being used in more than one place, and there's a track record of who's getting it. And even if in the case when we do deliver one, the pharmacist has to see it. They have to collect ID of, they have to see the ID health card of that person, and then in addition to that, they have to make sure that that's the person who accepts the prescription. So it's a little bit tricky, but it's not something that that we see a lot, and I think it probably doesn't necessarily fit into the primary person who's using our business.
Hello. How have you encrypted your transactions so that somebody can't just hijack or hack themselves some drugs?
So, yeah, I mean, we have a number of encryption methods that I don't feel like I want to necessarily discuss with everyone in this room. But, we've had, we've taken kind of measures for security, and we continue to kind of iterate on that and keep abreast kind of best standards there.
One last quick question. Very quick, and very quick answer, please.
How do you deal with privacy? Connecting people's emails with their prescriptions.
So typically, what we do is out the bat, like you're logging in using your email as your primary method, or potentially your phone number. that is, I think, a mode of communication that is kind of necessary for the transaction. How do we treat your email? It's only like any kind of communication in pharmacy. There's the pharmacist and the team kind of who manages your prescriptions. Those are the folks who message you and talk to you around those things. And so that's kind of what we stay. That's kind of the rule of thumb that we apply around privacy and using the method of transaction.
All right. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
So up next, we're going to have a fireside chat, which is the future of technology and media entertainment. And it'll be moderated by Amy Davis from IdeaBoost CFC. It'll include Dom Bartolucci, Sean Power, and Adam Raby. Please give them a warm welcome of applause. Hey, Dom, weren't you here in the morning?
I was here in the morning. I'm going to be moderating, actually.
Oh,
Amy's,
yeah?
Amy's going to be on the panel.
Oh, sorry about that. So it'll be moderated by Dom. So Dom is a founder and managing partner at The Working Group. Who here knows about what The Working Group is? Awesome. Okay, great, guys. So, all right. I'll give him an extra.
Thank you, Lana. Okay, let me get my notes out here. But we're going to make this fast and energetic as possible because you guys have been sitting in a sterile room for a little while and we went over time on the last one, so we're going to catch up a little bit. And if anyone feels the need to shout out or ask a question at any point during this, you should definitely do that. This is not your father's panel. Okay, so you know, it's an expression. Yeah, we'll start off with telling you a little bit about IdeaBoost, who's sort of sponsoring this session here. And Amy can speak all about that.
So I'll tell you guys a little bit about us for those of you who aren't familiar. So IdeaBoost is the accelerator run by the Canadian Film Centre. So we're Canada's only digital entertainment accelerator. So we support companies that have technology products in predictive analytics, VR, AR. Two of them are sitting next to me, to my left and right. And we give mentorship, funding. Dom is one of our executive advisors and a ton of support. So we are really proud to be supporting Fundica as well. So just to give you some context of who we are.
Okay, I've got a few questions to start us off. And I want a show of hands. So how many people here have actually used some form of a VR device?
That's pretty impressive.
Okay, so I'd say like 2/3. I wasn't expecting that many. How many people here have played some form of e-sports? All right, smaller sample. I'll flip it around. How many people here have invested money online before? Okay, about half. And how many people don't have enough time in the day to keep up with the news and everything that's going on? I'd say that's most people. Okay, so you're in luck, because these people here are active in that space right now, trying to solve the problems around those spaces, whether it's VR, esports, not having enough time to be able to consume the right type of news and get the right kind of information, how to invest. We've got Adam and Sean who are intimately involved in that, and we're going to ask just a few questions, and if there's questions that you guys want to ask, there'll be some space at the end for Q&A, or you can just shout it out if you feel like it. So I'll begin by asking in the entertainment media tech space, Adam, all of you, but starting with Adam, what do you see as a major problem or opportunity? What's the thing that you think about the most as a problem or opportunity in the media and entertainment space?
Well, it goes to, I guess, what you were questioning about, the fact that there's just too much information out there. I think everyone's inundated. We're getting better at disseminating information, but we are weak in the translation curation side. You know, humans were curating at first, but we're, you know, infinitely demanding technical solutions to really surmount the problem because it's just too much. And we really need to optimize that process. You know, if there's so much information out there, it's inhumanly accessible. How are we going to, you know, get to the piece of information that matters most to us, can impact our behavior and really drive us to make better decisions? And you know, we really need technology as a part of that solution just because of the scale of the problem.
How much has it scaled? How much worse has it got?
Oh, it's on, I would say exponential, but it's more like hyperbolic curve. It's just growing. You know, every day there are, you know, millions of news stories published across blogs, hundreds of thousands in editorial style media. You know, social media is just off the charts. There's so much content coming out in financial space, which is where we focus. There's the data is just beyond. There's trillions of data points pretty much every couple hours.
So. I think. I mean, I can anecdotally. It's like I used to be able to stay on top of the news and the things that I was interested until like Facebook came along.
Yeah.
And then everyone else started pointing out all the things that I wasn't keeping up with and wasn't able to keep on top of. Sean, I'll flip over to you. What is a problem and opportunity that you see in the media and technology space, entertainment space?
Media and entertainment. So I think that technology killed entertainment and is killing the artist in a slow, stabby death. Because I think it sucks to be an artist. Who here's an artist? Who here's like, or maybe had a dream once that they wanted to make their living doing their art? And like,
more and more start to emerge.
It's tough, right? Because like, we have to acknowledge the fact that for those of us who want to lift our hands, it's always like half up because we acknowledge the fact that we're not doing that, and it sucks. It really hurts because we feel like we've got a voice and we want to talk about that voice. But then, like, we go outside of our house and say, hey, we've got a voice, and every damn neighbor also has a voice as well. And then all of a sudden you're screaming saying, hey, you should pay attention to me, but everybody is saying pay attention to me as well. And that's possible because the internet's made it possible, right? We no longer live in a village where the best artist in the village is revered as being super awesome, and we try and, like, subsidize that person through like giving them food, giving them water, giving them shelter, giving them whatever, right? We live in a world where the best artist in the world needs to somehow be able to break out of the noise of everyone else, and that's technology's fault. And so when I hear like, you know, people saying like that it's the information is really awesome, it's really great, I think it also has a different effect on those of us who consider ourselves entertainers of some kind. And I think the opportunity there is that we can use technology to maybe help those people who are doing really awesome stuff be able to be seen a little bit more. But I kind of think that that's bullshit at the same time. I think that I don't know how the heck things are going to end up in the entertainment space, but I know that it's going to take decades until we figure out something that's viable.
So on that optimistic note, Amy.
Well, I would say just to kind of counteract that technology has also given a lot of opportunities to artists to go direct to the consumer, whether that's through YouTube or through Twitch or through platforms. So at the same time, technology is allowing the control to go back into the hands of the artists. So I actually think that there's a lot of opportunity happening right now in the entertainment sector. And certainly from the perspective of an entertainment company and a company like the Canadian Film Centre or the brands or the artists that we work with, production companies are looking to partner with startup companies that can help them understand their audiences, help them leverage their intellectual property. So there's a ton of opportunity.
Sean, I have a question to go from that.
We're gonna go back to him.
Yeah, because would you say that esports is a new form of entertainment? Would you call it totally new, something that never existed before?
No, absolutely not. Who here, raise your hand again, who here plays esports? Anybody here like done it professionally, like in a tournament or something like that? Yeah, what's your sport?
I played CS, Counter-Strike.
Oh, no way. Awesome. What, did you get like ranked? Like, are you high ranked?
Yeah, so at MLG Toronto 2006, we got first place.
What? That's pretty awesome. You know, so.
Stand up.
If Homeboy had said MLG 2016, if he was just born 10 years later and still had the skills to be able to compete now, he would probably be making about. Go back home, go play CS. He'd be making so much money. And I think like the thing is that there's a whole bunch of players who've been playing since forever. I have a world first in World of Warcraft. And you know, like I spent like so many hours of my life just training hour after hour, day after day to get to that point where we finally got something that like, you know, the World of Warcraft community is going to look back and say like, yeah, they got it. They got it first, right? And back then, people looked at people like me and said, you are insane and stupid and why would you do that, right? But this is like 2006. The first esports tournament was in 1980. It was Atari. 15,000 people showed up across just in New York alone to play Space Invaders. Super interesting story. This guy called Frank won the tournament in New York But this other person won the tournament in LA, and the other person, they did like this international final, which happened out in LA. This was for the high score in Space Invaders. And this woman called Becky Heinemann just destroyed Frank in the finals. And then she won highest title in Centipede and highest title in Tempest. And she was making her living for 2 years playing video games. And then she started a video game company which spawned a title called Baldur's Gate, which is a huge, huge RPG thing. She was arguably the first esports pro, and that's 1980. So is it a new thing? Absolutely not. There have been people who have been playing Quake since like 1991 and just like fragging noobs since forever.
Fragging noobs. Adam, what do you think about is there's big data, there's machine learning. Are those two things merging? Are those two things different sides of the same coin? How do you relate those?
Yeah, so big data, often people think of as just the accumulation of data. It really takes advantage of a lot of different fields that include machine learning. But what I think people need to focus on is that it's not just about acquiring a lot of data. It's also about how you model it. Is it in a way that can be interpreted and digested down? I think there was a trend initially when everyone wanted to capture as much data as possible and they didn't know what to do with it. And I think the new wave is we need to focus on a lot of tools that are going to filter down the data as much as or as fast as we accumulate it, because what are we going to do with tons of data that we can't use? So it's really about the interpretation layer. And I think machine learning is kind of the key to that. And they're both maturing at around the same time. I think we have more data now that we can make good use of. But machine learning is growing to the point where it actually is able to help us, you know, digest it down. So I think it's on trend.
Sean?
So to counteract that, I think, so Dave McClure said that the most successful startups are startups that get people laid, that get people paid, or that get people made, as in their careers are made. And I think that, like, so we do machine learning and all that stuff, right? Big data is great, awesome. But if I'm not getting a person in esports laid, paid, or made, I'm not doing my job. And so I think, like, and what that means really is that, like, a lot of us who are into big data, and I'm like super, super, super nerdy when it comes to big data. I've written books on it. I go so deep. But one of the things that I constantly have to practice is to remind myself that if I've got a really, really interesting data set, at the end of the day, it's that end user in their life being better that matters. And I can have all of the data in the world, but if I'm not measurably impacting that end user, I'm screwed. I've got nothing.
I think it's a funny analogy too. The your product or your service needs to make someone get paid, laid, or made. To do well, Kathy Sierra took that to another level where she pointed out that your product needs to make you look, doesn't have to make you more productive. It just needs to make you look awesome to your colleagues and friends. And if you can produce, you can produce that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think, I don't know if you caught the Michael Hyatt presentation earlier, but he said it very well, which is everyone's a capitalist inside. So if you're not benefiting the person or your user, then you've got a question about your product.
Yeah, but I would echo that as well, and I agree with you. It's all about behaviorally impacting information, really. So like I said, you know, people are accumulating a lot of what I almost call dumb data because it doesn't do anything for them. So you know, translating that data into something that will impact people's real lives, make them make smarter decisions, or help them save time, improve their efficiency, changes the game for how they interact with the world. So
or get the high score.
Yeah.
So
high score. Or invest in the right things, right?
So let's talk about then mistakes that you've made. What would be the biggest or one of the bigger mistakes that you've made in your experience as a startup founder or you know, in your business life?
Probably underestimating the startup world to an extent. It's obviously very challenging, but that's also one of the greatest benefits to it. In addition to that, maybe being you know, naive at times, but I'm generally a believer that mistakes are what makes startups great. I think we thrive off of failure and don't even try to call it failure because it's the seeds of kind of the productivity of how startups operate. So I almost can't name a mistake because that mistake was something that is, you know, been a very important source of growth.
Amy, do you have anything to tell us about mistakes?
Well, apart from what I told you earlier, which I might not mention right now, but no, I think, you know, because I also launched my own business as well as running this accelerator, but I think just not doing the due diligence on the financial model itself and woefully underestimating the costs associated with running a startup. Because I think the planning out your financials up front and really understanding where you're going to be in 3 years' time is absolutely critical.
I hate this question because I can give you guys a bullshit answer, but I don't really bullshit. So it's not. It's really not a nice story. It's not a good story. This is my seventh startup that I'm working on now. One of the startups in particular went really, really well. About 160 employees by the time that all was said and done, and the acquisition happened, and the culture was shit. It was dog shit, and it was completely my and our fault for a wide variety of reasons. I would say it was toxic to women in the company. It was shitty to people that didn't know domain expertise well. It was just rife full of examples of things that I never, ever, ever, ever want to do again. And it took some time for kind of me to look back and realize, and I mean, I think all the employees from that company, I think a majority of them would say that we did really well and they were really happy. But I still, the things that stay with me are the times when we screwed up a lot. And so the biggest mistakes is that for a time in my career, I didn't realize how important things like diversity and culture and how important it is to keep those things as a conscious decision. And like, I can talk about it till the cows come home. I actually don't talk about it a lot, but I'm the kind of person that just does shit and like acts on, like when I learn something, I just do something about it. So we're a gaming company, and the vast majority of the people who are on our cap table are women or minorities. We've got like six figures in the bank right now. I'd say that we're probably one of the startups in Canada that has the most women who have invested in it. I don't know what the stats are. I don't have any citation, but we're well on our way there. I'm proud of that. I'm proud of the fact that there's not a single non-minority in our team, which is weird. So like maybe like it'll be fun to get someone who like is the opposite of a minority because they're going to be the minority in our company. And all in all, what that does, if for no other reason, it wasn't necessarily by design, because every single person that's in our cap table or is in our company are just the best person for the job, right? They're the best person for our culture. but it certainly, like 10 years later from what I say is the biggest mistake, which I didn't pay attention to culture, when Heather, my co-founder, and I talk about the kind of company that we want to run, we explicitly state that to our employees. We talk about it often, and we just try to walk the walk more than talk to talk. And for us, that's something really important. So it's not a joking thing. It really sucks. I really fucked up 10 years ago, and I just don't ever want that to happen again. And I hope that you guys, like if you guys have questions about culture or whatever, just come and talk to me. I definitely have a lot of things to share.
So it sounds like there's an opening for old white men at your company. Okay. Well, that's an interesting thing when like, yeah, at the working group and then with Idea Boost, when looking at startups who, you know, come to apply for investment or for help with their product development, there's this, you know, this category, this age spectrum. Generally, we see everyone from age 20 to age 50. And there's a different set of criteria, I think, that I look at those startups at the different age groups. Early, when you're really young, it's like, okay, if you've got a really risky startup, that's okay. That's cool, because you know you're comfortable living on ramen and like, you know, not having high living expenses. You don't have a mortgage. You probably don't have a family, so you can ride out. You can be a cockroach startup for many years, just crawling along, figuring out how to make this thing work, and just live, get by. If you've got an older entrepreneur, I'm not comfortable like supporting and saying go for it on a super risky, you know, startup for them unless they're backed by a whole bunch of money and they're going to be comfortable. I would look, you know, for that type of startup, you want domain expertise, you want a great network, you want sort of inroads into customers. You don't want to have a high, super high, as high risk. It's always risky, but not as high risk as a very young entrepreneur. Why don't we, do we have some questions? Are there questions that you guys want to ask about anything with to do with media entertainment technology about their startups? Hands up, anyone? Young man, what's your question?
Trends we're seeing today, so kind of, you know, two different ends of the spectrum, but where do you kind of see the most promising technologies coming out of media?
It's so hard. Just the space is so full of disruption. There's so much, like, and I mean disruption as in, like, the consumers are disrupting the model, not the companies are disrupting the ecosystem, right? Like, we don't want to pay for shit at the end of the day, like, and the kids, especially like kids like the iGen and millennials, like, we don't want to pay for music, we don't want to pay for movies, we just want to stream that shit or just download it off a torrent site, and that's happening just like worldwide. And so where do I see the areas, I think, of innovation? It'll be, I think, the people who figure out ways where we can work with consumers to kind of get them used to a model where the artist deserves some kind of recognition and financial compensation. And if that means killing an entire industry of middlemen, then I'm all for it, as long as the artists are making money at the end of the day. The risk with killing the middlemen is that the middlemen are sometimes propping up some of the larger projects that are amazing and fantastic. I think that a lot of the areas of innovation are going to go around the delivery mechanism and financial levers that compensate an artist. And right now it's not working. Like, on Spotify, if I'm putting my banjo out and everybody's, like, 10 million people are listening to me play banjo, I can maybe afford to buy a string, just one. Just right? And, like, that doesn't work.
So the question was initially, what are the trends that you see in media and technology, in case people in the back couldn't hear that?
I mean, we kind of joked earlier of this idea of, you know, singularity is coming closer and closer, but certainly from the CFC's perspective, we are investing heavily and looking at virtual reality and augmented reality, and I think it's becoming clearer that technology is becoming intertwined with the human experience more and more, and that immersive entertainment is becoming more prevalent. So certainly virtual reality and AR would be an area that I'm keeping a close eye on.
Yeah, and I'll add to that as well. It's really the fact that we're extending beyond our human capabilities. You know, people are holding more memory on their smartwatches or their smartphones, so, you know, their brains can think further than they could before. Big data systems are trying to access people to webs of information in the cloud, where, you know, they can just extend beyond. The car made us run faster than we could ever do, and now we travel distances with airplanes, things like that. We have that new biological extension that we're levering with technology, and media is a huge part of that.
So I've got a question. How many people here, we'll get to two questions in a moment. How many people here are involved or founding or involved in a startup right now? Okay, and so on the entertainment side versus media side, how many of you would you classify yourself as entertainment-related startup? Okay, there's a bunch here. And on the media, more media side, what would you say?
Sucks to be us.
So fewer on the media side than the entertainment.
If I don't recognize your face, that's the problem. Like, there's so few of us who are doing stuff in entertainment, and who have the guts to do stuff in entertainment, because we all should be in LA, right? We're not, and, like, that's okay. But, like, we can only rely on each other to help each other out, right? So if, like, again, if I don't know your name, I can't do an intro when I'm in LA next week to that person that I just met. That would be super awesome for you to meet. Right?
You should come to Idea Boost.
Yes, Idea Boost. Network Connect. That's right. Yeah, questions. Sorry. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So for people
think the part of the roadshow that we're doing is kind of, and a few of, I mean, there are really five startups, you know, six now that I've heard of in the esports space in Canada. There's us, Revlo, Battlefy, the content distribution network company that I always forget their names. Of course, there's the Score. There's you guys. I think I'm missing one, and I hope I'm not missing. Anyways, apologies to the founder, who's probably going to be grumpy if they see this. So I think we're all kind of like starting to socialize the fact that esports has become something big. It's tough to be on the tip of the waves. The onus is on us to prove through the amount of clients and customers that we have and the velocity of clients and customers that we have to get there. And it sucks to be us because we often need to front the money so that we can make that happen and then hope to recoup those costs. And that's a really, really big risk. It puts you at a severe disadvantage, and I have no beautiful, amazing, awesome silver bullet that I can share with you other than nice than to say feel your pain, and I'm happy to talk about it.
We have a comment on here or a different question? Okay, we'll get to you in a second. Amy, why don't you tell us about Idea Boost, because that sounds like the perfect candidate to get involved.
I mean, I would just say that there's different funding sources out there. You can look at certain government funds, which I'm happy to talk to you about as well as an accelerator like ours that will take very early stage companies. We are specifically looking to support companies in media entertainment, but we're pretty unique in Canada, I will say that.
to be honest, I'm not just saying this. I know that, like, I know it'll sound so douchey right now.
The checks in the mail.
I'm gonna let you finish, Kanye. they're the only ones that got it at our early stage. Now, it's not like IAF and a whole bunch of the folks who I see here also get it, but we were just too early stage. But like, they were like, you know what? Screw it, we're going in because just the sheer potential of this, I think, is massive, and we like you guys. I think they like us, maybe a little bit less now. But honestly, the CFC folks, for all of you folks who are in media, like I've been in media for a portion of my career, and like I said, not a lot of people in Canada get it. I think they're one of the ones that are positioning themselves as understanding it, and being through the program, I can attest to the fact that they're actually really dope.
Good. We had a question over here.
Yeah, I read both sides of that argument, to be honest. I've read a lot of Ray Kurzweil's work and talking about the singularity and things like that. I generally do think that trend is true. And there's another big thinker who's kind of the antithetical vibe to that. He's a finance writer named Nassim Taleb. And he's got the opposite idea. He thinks we're in this whole neomania and we live in old technologies. Most of the time, you know, you're having dinner and, you know, the chairs you're sitting on are thousands of years old. Your shoes are thousands of years old. You're eating over a fire and glasses. These are all thousands of year old technology. And those really stood the test of time. And new technologies, you know, come and go very quickly. But those kind of buildings and things like that have, you know, stayed that test. So I subscribe to kind of both philosophies. I think there is a bridge there. For the most part, I do believe that, yeah, we're going to extend at some point. I don't know if it's 2041 or wherever Ray Kurzweil pegged it, but at some point, I do believe think we'll become very technologically integrated. You know, we'll put computer chips in our brains. We'll become cyborgic. I mean, we already are to some extent, but we'll demand that efficiency to be even, you know, clearer to the point. And we want to extend beyond our imaginations, and we need technology to do it.
I don't think it matters. It doesn't matter if it helps us be more human. Then that's all that matters. Right, like Facebook helps us be more human because we can communicate more with our friends. And so everyone in the world is just like, I want to be more social.
Yep.
I
think if VR friends in real life, like you do on Facebook.
Well, Sean does.
Sean number, does. That's different.
I thought that was an excellent point and I wouldn't add to it, but just one thing, if you are, I think, I just want to point, there's a really interesting satirical UK show that kind of addresses some of these issues by Charlie Booker called Black Mirror, so if you haven't seen it, well, check it out, someone has.
The
yeah.
First, the first episode.
It's brilliant.
Got a question?
Well, from our perspective, we're focused on financial media, and obviously there's an easier case because it affects people's bottom line, the information they're getting, and they do pay for that type of media. So I can't speak as well to it as the other media types, but it's really about adding value as much as possible and rethinking it. I think there was a mistake in the music industry and other industries where they went very litigious as soon as they saw technology coming out, instead of thinking on how to innovate and find a different way to capture. And even now they've evolved where, I don't know, it's concerts or merchandise. You gotta look for what's really scarce, right? Things that are on the route to being very available are not gonna demand value. So listen to scarcity, basically. Where there's high demand, there will be a high price. And that's where we should be focusing our energy and innovating.
Yeah, I mean, like, I'm proud to be an O'Reilly author, and I think Tim's done a lot to kind of disrupt the way that the model looks like for authors. Like, I made nothing off of my book, but I got so much, like, I got made because I wrote a book, but I made nothing, right? So, laid, paid, made. Well, I won't talk about the second one, but the first and the third, I didn't get paid, but my career got made because I wrote a book. And that's because Tim recognized that one of the best things that he can do for authors is put us in front of stages with really, really smart people. And those really smart people are gonna say, wow, that's an expert in X, and I need X, right? And so he recognized that the book industry wasn't about the book, it was about the author and about connecting the author with really smart people. So if I think of Canadian innovators in the publishing space, Hugh MacLeod by far is like is doing some amazing stuff with Pressbook and just all the stuff that he's been. LibriVox was like one of his creations just like 10 years ago or 12 years ago. And so what Hugh has been doing, and I think Mitch Joel is thinking a lot about these things as well. What they're doing in Canada, I think Tim O'Reilly is doing in leaps and bounds in the ecosystem in the U.S.
I see blockchain merging with the publishing industry in a sense of creating an ownership distribution network where your content gets protected. And I can see that as being potentially one business model going
and
forward.
I just, you know, and obviously we've seen this idea of kind of the Uberization of media, but we're seeing more and more companies that are coming in with this idea of a sharing economy and a sharing economy model. So I think that's definitely, we're going to see more of that.
So I got two more questions. One was back there and one's right over here. So first in the back there. No, that's you, woman with the long hair. Yeah.
Well, I mean, it's just our industry is governed by where our attention is, right? All of us are going to go home, and for those of us that are going to kick open something, we're either going to watch a video, some of us are going to watch Netflix, some of us are going to watch, like, whatever. Like, that's the, like, just these people in here are the people whose attention you're fighting for, right? And if, so I think, like, when you're saying that, there's not a death of content, right? We're seeing more streaming that's happening than ever before. I think the shows on Netflix are some of the better shows that I've seen in a long, long time. And you know, like it gives me kind of a beginning and an end where, like, which I find like the quality is just excellent most of the time. And so, I think.
What about user generated content though?
Amy will have some really, really good insight on this. And my bookend is that I think you have potential more than ever before to be able to do really cool stuff. It just really depends on how big your pocketbook is and how dope you are executing on a good idea.
I think it goes back to you can't be all things to all people, and it still goes back to audiences. I think you've got to know where your audiences are and on which platform, because different platforms, whether it's Snapchat, or Facebook, or YouTube, they have different demographics, different people who are on those platforms, and you've got to really understand what your content is, who your audiences are, and where you should be to make sure that you're reaching them. And it might be one, it might be two, it might be five platforms.
Twitch is a good example of that.
And
go ahead. No, that's all I had to add.
Question here, yeah.
This question is for Adam.
Yeah.
So, I'm in love with Google.
Okay.
Why? Because I don't need to use my imagination.
Right.
And I don't want to use my favorite resource. So I want to know if you have an insight of what comes after Bloomberg.
you're referring, do you use Bloomberg from the public media site, or do you use the terminal?
Everything.
Okay.
The satellite radio.
Okay, cool, yeah. So to me, it's still kind of the old editorial model as far as the media production, and as far as the tools and dashboards, it's kind of the kitchen sink and some in terms of just providing every tool out there. So it's like the library of Alexandria of financial information. I think the next kind of wave is about finding context, insight, and driving, you know, you to the best information you can. So there's two realms. One is Bloomberg's kind of you, other than, I guess, you know, the radio or the TV, you go in to pull out of the terminal when you want something out of it. I think the best media in the future is going to come to you when you need it the most, on top of the fact that it's hopefully going to give you a lot more context and insight, and also lower the latency, because even journalists are pretty slow to the game in finding it out, and Bloomberg may not be the first to report the story. They'll get it from somewhere else where they're aggregating, but I think those kind of tools are really going to be the impact going forward. So it's not just about tools. I think it's context and insight are really what's demanded for the next wave. Pardon?
Who's doing it?
That's what we do. Yeah, and you know,
are you planted?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, there's
an investor,
right? Yeah, right. Yeah, thank you for that. There's a few others in the space, obviously. You know, it is the holy grail of how we can really translate information into something that can, you know, make the markets more efficient. I still think you know, better information increases efficiency, makes everything better across the world. So hopefully we can make an impact in that.
Okay, I think we're going to wrap it up. Laid, made, or paid. Remember that. Thanks very much, everyone.
All right, thank you. That was great. Thank you, Dom, for leading that. Adam, Sean, and Amy. Important note, if these guys are expert in media, and growing media companies, if you want to learn more, go to ideaboost.ca. That's where you want to go, and you basically apply to Connect, Network Connect. So thank you very much for that. Interesting, always very much a fast-developing field. There's lots to learn.
And up next, we have our next pitch, Sampler. All right, so we're ready to go for the next pitch. So, Marie. All right, Marie, take it away. Please give a warm welcome round of applause to Marie. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. All right, I'm Marie Chevrier, and I'm from Sampler. We're an online sampling management and analytics platform. We work with brands like L'Oreal and Mondelez to distribute their product samples online. So I'm sure all of you have received, oops, how did that work? I'm sure all of you have received a free product sample in store before, or even on a street corner, right? Well, the problem with traditional sampling strategies is that they're quite untargeted. In fact, it's really, really hard for a brand manager to actually receive any insight on exactly who they're distributing the product sample to. It offers zero remarketing opportunity, and therefore even less opportunity to track ROI. By moving product sampling online, brands and the main reason for that is because brands lose touch with the customer the moment they walk away with the offer. Now, by moving product sampling online, brands are able to target the right audience. They're able to continue the conversation with the consumer past the initial trial, effectively start measuring their ROI, and optimize their sampling strategy from campaign to campaign. Now, when I, as a marketer, started moving product sampling online for a baby brand that I worked with, I realized that I needed to think about 6 different categories of things and use anywhere between 6 to 12 different technologies to effectively distribute these samples. That's when I realized there was a need in the market for a product. Sampler is an application that allows brands to distribute more targeted, measurable, and social products, and I'll walk you through how it works. If the brand manager at Ritz wants to set up an offer, he just has to log in, set up the offer by uploading a picture, writing a short description, and saying exactly who he wants to reach. So that's women between the ages of 18 to 35 that live in California, for example. From there, he can also customize a fully branded experience that the consumer will go through in order to claim her offer. In this example, we actually ran targeted ads across a couple channels, including Facebook, and only the consumers that were targeted by the ad could actually reach the offer. Once they did, they had to connect with Sampler, and therefore we have a centralized database that ensures that consumers can only claim one of each sample one time. And brands like Mondelez can start setting up business rules that say that they only want to distribute one pack of Ritz to one consumer each year. If the brand wants, they can also allow consumers to share samples with friends across Facebook, WhatsApp, Viber, and SMS. Most recently, we also started Sampler's Network. The network is a network of publishers that allows brands to actually reach these targeted audiences with really, really cool publications. For example, in the parenting space, where we have actual partnerships with networks like Mom365 and Bundu. This puts us at 12 million profiles of moms that these brands can actually go and target. And if you're in the media space, you know that a lot of these companies, or a lot of these publishers, are really stressed at monetizing in different ways. And this is a really good way for them to monetize product sampling with their already existing CPG clients. The other thing that the brand can do is go into our dashboard and see exactly who they're sampling to, right? So age, gender, location, they could see how their campaign's performing across different cities or across different states. And then they can use that data to remarket to the customer with conversion reminders, follow-up surveys, even follow-up coupons, and even retargeted ads. The case study that I was talking about with Ritz actually was a really, really good one. So what we did is we actually ran a pilot in store with their typical provider at Albertsons Safeway, and they handed out one Ritz cracker at the demo table. Online, we actually did the campaign that I just showed, and offline, they were reaching the right person 6% of the time, whereas online, we were reaching the right person 100% of the time. So when you break it down to a cost per targeted sample, Sampler was 20% less expensive than traditional sampling. So far, Sampler has actually distributed 500,000 samples. We've done that across 150 customers across 6 different industries, including the 4 of the top 10 global CPGs. We raised $1 million seed round last December, and we grew the team to 14 and effectively scaled our sales up to $60,000 monthly. The industry we're going after is a $7 billion industry. If you break it down, the CPG revenues, 15% of the CPG revenues is spent on marketing, 10% of that on sampling, and we expect one-third of all sampling to move to digital. Our competition has been really focused on audience. I'm sure some of you have seen subscription boxes or websites where you can actually go and register for free samples. If you think about it, those are filled with a lot of people that just want free stuff or high product switchers. What we want to do is put the sample in front of the right audience at the right time and not really rely on a freebie hunting audience. The other thing that we've done is that we've really positioned ourselves as a platform, so we're a tool for the CPG brands, and we're not reselling our audience over and over again. So as far as what we're doing right now, so we're raising another $1 million round. This one is the seed extension. It's to get us to our Series A milestones by accelerating our product roadmap, scaling our sales and marketing teams, as well as exploring more strategic partnerships with publishers, agencies, and retailers. At this point, the round's actually 80% committed. So the reason that we're participating today is because we would want to travel to San Francisco to prepare for our Series A. as far as who we are. So I'm Marie Chevrier. I'm the founder. I started my career in agency. Then I moved to venture capital. So I worked at Rocket Internet in New York City, circled on three different business models, including a subscription box. And then Eric is our VP of product. He's had a lot of experience scaling up, down, and all the way to acquisition companies like Extend Media that got sold to Cisco. We're a team of 14 just here in Toronto. Super proud to say we're extremely diverse. We have 50% women, as you can notice from this. And yeah, really strong team. Thank you. Sorry, I'm so tired. We just like got 80% commit. So I'm like, cool.
Revenue right now?
Yeah, so we're at 60K monthly. Okay.
And then with this current round, how far is that going to take you?
So that actually takes us 16 months out to our Series A financing, but we actually hit a break-even point before then. Yep.
So I'll repeat the question.
Yeah.
How does this integrate with the campaigns that the brands are running themselves on the social platforms? And
yeah, so they can actually use our campaign manager to create their own campaigns. So you can integrate that technology into your Facebook page, into your website, or even into your newsletter. So that those are really good ways for them to do their own.
Okay.
And then let's say there's a lot of brands, like obviously the Ritz crackers, like they can do their own, but there's a lot of niche brands that don't have audiences, right? So if you're thinking of like a small brand that's launching in Whole Foods, if they want to distribute 500 samples to people that live around the Whole Foods, there's no really way to do that. So through our publisher network, they can do that.
So just a quick follow-up. Is that 60K monthly? Like
that's
recurring?
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Also, so when you say you have 150 customers, like which is very impressive, and four of the top 10 CPGs, like, when you look at a customer, is that Ritz? Like, is that a brand?
It's a brand.
So those would be within those CPGs because they'll have multiple.
That's correct. Okay. So we just actually started penetrating the CPGs. So right now, like just under the L'Oreal umbrella, we have two brands. Under the Mondelez umbrella, we have four. But total, it's 150 brands.
And is there an opportunity to expand within
Exactly. So part of this raise is the realization that we needed kind of an enterprise salesperson to manage that process. So obviously, moving from seed to Series A, I have the opportunity to now hire some more like senior people to help out with that.
Cool.
Thank you. Yep.
I'm not familiar with the space, so my question may be very simple.
No problem.
So you guys are, when you are trying to help these companies sample, right? It's just for the purpose of advertising on their end? So
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's a, sorry, I cut you off. Were you done?
I have a follow-up question.
Okay. Yeah, so plainly why a brand would want to distribute product samples is because they want to drive brand awareness. So there's two reasons you want to drive brand awareness. It's either to grow one customer across different categories, and sometimes it's to educate the consumer further on the product and potentially encourage repeat purchase. The other reason is for pure awareness, right? Like some brands launch, like Red Bull is a great story of a company that really relied on product sampling in order to spread awareness of their brand. But brands of all shapes and sizes rely on sampling, including Ritz. Like Ritz has 35% penetration, household penetration in the US. That means that 35% of households buy Ritz. So you'd think, why do they want to sample? Well, when they came up with their brand new packaging, they had to sample for women, women they were targeting, to actually find the product in the aisle. So you never really stop needing product sampling. Good question.
Thank you. Also, so you guys are not about feedback at all, right? Or is that integrated into it?
It is, yeah. So I went that through that quickly, but one of the remarketing cadences that you have is that 7 days after the sample has been received, there's a follow-up survey, and 7 days after that, there's a follow-up coupon. The really cool thing that I didn't say, too, is in that Ritz case study, we tracked that 17% of the people that we had sampled to purchased another box or more in the next 90 days. So we're able to do that, and that's never been seen in the space. So not only am I telling brands, hey, I'll distribute to our targeted audience at a predictable cost, but I'll also tell you that your ROI.
Thank you. Yeah, I just was interested in knowing that it's like an end-to-end solution.
It's awesome.
Awesome. Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much, Mary.
Thank you, everyone.
So who's been having fun listening to pitches and inspired right now and wants to raise funding? Who here is raising funding right now? Starting up a business? Who here is just because Fundica Rocha is awesome? Everyone should be there. Okay. All right. Okay. So the reason why I ask, it's because our next road talk will be provided by Mike Lee, who's the president of Fundica, and he's also going to be talking to you about the W's of funding. So he'll be telling you how to find funding, when to find funding, and what kind of funding you can get. So let me just call him up. Thank you. He's here. All right. Give it up for Mike Lee, president of Fundica. He's also my boss, so can we do this again? Give it up! I love doing that.
All right. All right. Thank you, Lana. Lana actually runs a roadshow, so the idea with this presentation is really just to kind of give some one-on-ones on funding. I'm going to go through it. It's going to be about 15, 20 minutes only. I'm going to catch up a little on the schedule. We're going to try and go through some of the basic things. We get a lot of funders that we work with, and we get a lot of feedback from them as to what the entrepreneurs are doing right or wrong. And hopefully we'll cover some of the things that we see, you know, kind of as persistent kind of problems or things that people don't understand that well. So the first question people have is, you know, am I fundable or not? And we heard a few different expressions today. Paid, laid, made. A few other ones came up. This one here is about the asses. So there's a VC in the States called Jeff Clavier, and he came up with something called the three asses. And I'm going to kind of extend this into the four asses. So if you're fundable or not is, do you have the four asses? And the four asses are, first of all, do you have a smart-ass team? And first and foremost, that's what you need. When you're starting a company, you really need that smart-ass team. There should be a few other qualities in that as well, but smart-ass is really what you need. The second thing is, do you have a kick-ass product or idea? Is it something that really resonates? Is it something people are really interested in taking, in using, in going to the next level with? The third thing is, do you have a big-ass market? So I hear a lot of smart entrepreneurs working in their basement. They develop some cool technology, but when you come down to it, they're not exactly sure how big the market is or where the market is. So make sure you have that really big market. And the bigger, we'll get into more detail as we go in here, but if you're going to really the big VCs, they're going to expect a super big-ass market. So make sure that market is huge. Doesn't mean you're going to go get it all right away, but you need that big market. And the fourth ass, and this is one I've kind of added, is that you need a thick-ass wallet. And that's right from the start. So when people say, it's great, you're a startup, you got a great market, you got a great team, you got a great product, you need a little bit of fuel to get the whole motor started. And that fuel is going to come from a few different sources. It could be you have some savings. It could be that you have some, you know, your parents have some money they'll give you. You've inherited some. Or you have one of your partners perhaps is working, but you need some kind of money to kind of keep you going through those early days. So those are really the things to see if you are fundable or not. It's also nice to have a little traction once you get going. It often gets a lot easier, but this is kind of the square one where it starts. So the four asses. The second thing is where to find funding. So there's a lot of different sources out there, and 5 years ago, we were doing a lot of consulting for companies, helping them identify different sources that were available, and it was a kind of a painful task. We go through an Excel sheet and kind of pull together all the funding sources. We put that into Access, and then eventually we said, "There's enough of this. Let's put it all in one place, and let's make it so the crowd can actually say which programs should be there, and more make it as friendly as possible." So we built Fundica, and it is a source of all the funding out there. It is a free source, and it's free thanks to all our partners, which help kind of fund the roadshow and Fundica. And on it, you'll find all the traditional funding sources. You'll find advisors, and advisors also can sign up for free. And we keep the whole thing up to date with internet bots that do some tracking of existing programs, and they do discovery of new ones. And we also have a research team. And most importantly, we have funders that come in. So for example, Mars this week went in and updated their program. So different groups that have funding come in there. So we truly try to make this thing easy to use, up to date, and comprehensive. It's not the only place. There's other places to find funding as well, but I think it's a good one for you. So who provides funding? This is an important slide. We often, I think, people are not sure where and why and how and what all this funding is all about. It really needs to be broken down to what type of funding you're looking at before you do anything. So the first thing is tax credits. Tax credits are predefined. It's by the law. It's not if they like you or if they don't. It really is just, do you fit into the way the tax code is written or not? So really no emotion. The second one is grants. So grants, you're still working with the government. Here it really depends on knowing when the money comes out and how to apply to it. You really got to get in line. It's something where the reviewer on the other side and the government side, they're going to look at and say, is this good for society? So the societal benefit, in certain cases, it's certain very specific criteria looking for, trying to get young people employed, trying to get older people employed, trying to get, you know, help the environment. So depending on exactly what their goals are, you need to know those. But at the end of the day, it's really about helping society. It's really about making all of us wealthier long term. Third thing is public loans, very similar to grants. They look at more factors. They often go in more depth. They may, in many cases, they're going to look at getting more information out of the company before they invest it. But it comes down to, do they like what you're doing, and does it fit into what they see as helping society? So that's kind of public loan. Private loan is the next one. And now we start, things kind of change. So it's no longer for the benefit of society. Now it's really return on investment. The private loans is by far the largest amount of money lent out, but unfortunately very little of it is going to go to startups. And that's because really they're looking for two things, either assets or cash flow. And when I say cash flow, it's kind of a regular history of cash flow. If you don't have assets or you don't have a regular history of cash flow, private sector loans almost all the time are just a waste of time. And in that case, when you do have those, you have that asset or you have cash flow, they're really just wanting to make sure, they're not looking to make a lot of money, but they want to make real sure that they're not going to lose any. So first and foremost, they don't want to lose any money. They want to just sit there and they make their interest rate, be it a few percent, be it up to, you know, 20, in some cases a little bit more. But that's their kind of motivation. Next category is angel investors. So at this point, it's starting to get more expensive. The expectations are getting higher. Most angels look for at least 15%. Some will tell you 30, 40, 50%, but it's at least that. The most important thing there is that they really believe in you. So they're going to look at you, and the team is particularly important, but they really want to just believe in what you're doing. The second thing is they want to make sure that if you do need to get a lot of funding, they're able to participate along the whole kind of spectrum. If they're coming in really early and they realize you need $1 billion, and they can only afford to invest, you know, $10,000, it's unlikely it'll be the right investment for them. They really want to get an investment where they can see it, be part of it as it goes forward, and they want to make sure they're there long enough and they can help you far enough so they can get to cash flow positive in most cases. A lot of angel investors will invest in traditional businesses, not necessarily startups, kind of more traditional ones, but some of them will invest in kind of startups and tech companies. The last category, and really the most or the least desirable funding, is venture capital. It is the most expensive. They're going to put the most controls in place. They're going to make your life more difficult than any of the ones above it. So although in a lot of cases people think, oh, I've gotten to the promised land, I just got some great VC funding, there's the other side of the coin to that, where they've now you're locked in. You're not going anywhere. They more or less are coming in pretty strong here, and they expect to make a very good return or they will not be happy. Most of the companies will fail, but they're going to push all of them as far as they can so that the ones that do succeed, succeed very well. They very much look for traction, and important to know with a VC fund is that they typically have a period when they get the money, so they close the fund, and then they have a period when they have to actually give back to the investors, the limited partners, generally speaking. So that's often about 7 years. So if you get a fund that just got some money, great. They're going to be funding all kinds of projects. They got 7 years, you know, for companies to expand. But if you get a fund that's towards the later years, they're likely not going to be able to fund very much because they know they have to get that money out or have to do the best job they can to try and get that money out by the end. So, and often at that phase as well, they don't have as much money left. So there's some very large funds across Canada. Some of them are well-funded. Others are closer to the end of their fund, and then, you know, and maybe the end of, you know, when we see them as well, but that's the way it works. The ones that do well, they typically have a series one, two, three. I think earlier today, Real Ventures talked about this, their third fund they're on, so they kind of got that. Most funds need that. Some of them are do not have a time horizon. For example, OMERS is an evergreen fund, so they're run by the OMERS, the kind of the pension group, and their fund, they always have money. So it's a little bit different in their case. But most VCs kind of have a beginning and an end, so it's important to know where you fit in. So that's kind of the, you know, who provides the funding. So important to know their motivation behind it. So what kind of funding do you find? So if you went into Fundeek and you just typed in a bit of information, this will take you, you know, 30 seconds, a minute tops. You'll find out different funding available. So in this case here, we've broken it down into the categories we saw before. So we have this first tab, which really has favorites. So it has the ones we think are the best fit for you, or the ones that you as well may decide you like as well, so you favorite. After that, we have grants, tax credits, loans, loan guarantees, equity. We added a tab, advisors. So advisors trying to fit in there as well. So these are the different types of programs that will be available. And if we click into one, say the MyTax one, Accelerate, you see a little bit about the program, the funding limits, the eligible expenditures, contact information, guidelines and forms, and you can go to the website. So it's an idea of trying to really summarize the information, and this information, again, has been brought together by a research team, it's been brought together by funders, or it's been, you know, brought together by a bot. So this doesn't do all the work for you, though. This is just going to tell you what it's about. After that, the real work starts, which is the application. And before you even start the application, the most important thing is to pick really the programs that fit best for you. I do not advise people go out and apply to 20 different programs. Your business is going to be lost. You're going to become a professional grant applicant. You're not going to be running your business. Pick the two or three. In some cases, there's none. If there's none, that's okay. Just move on. But make sure you understand what's there, prioritize them, and pick the top ones. Which kind of takes me to what I think is the most important slide I have here, and how to get funded. So the important thing with getting funded is really being systematic, going through the steps. And, you know, there's some very smart people I worked with. Unfortunately, sometimes they have not gone through the steps. And in this day and age, it's really important to go through it. The funders see it. But it also just makes a lot of sense. So the first thing, is it commercially viable, and is there a market for it? This is something you can test very easily. There's lots of ways to do it on the web, lots of ways to do it in person. You don't even have to go on the web. You should be testing this. You should be doing your homework on this. So that's the very first thing. Once you can say you do have commercial viability and you have a market, you need to build a team. It's very, very rare that an individual can take a business and grow it to a very large one. We often hear about, you know, the Bill Gates and the, you know, Zuckerbergs, but there's the whole team around them, which were around them right from the beginning, pretty much. So build that core team. You really need that. If you're not able to sell, you know, co-founders to jump in on the business, how are you going to sell, you know, investors? How are you going to sell clients? So try to get that core team. Then the fourth ask there, make sure you have a little bit of cash in hand. Because if you're always running out of cash and you can't really get anything done, it's going to be extremely frustrating. So you need a little bit of cash. So be it you have some investment, one of you still works part-time or full-time, or somehow you've managed to get a little bit of bootstrapping through consulting or the like. So that's really the pre-funding part, but that is the most important part. So make sure you have the market, the viability, the team, a little bit of cash in hand. Then you're ready to really go look at getting some funding. The first thing you look at is the government funding. In terms of government funding, we talked about it a bit before. The nice thing about this is when you go further along, if you actually have some funding, it makes the investors feel better. They say, oh, I'm not the first one in, even if it's small amounts. It's also the cheapest money to get. Secondly, go to the loans, if that makes sense. If you're a startup, you have no cash in the bank or no assets, and you have no cash flow, there's a couple loans you may look at, but more than likely you'll kind of pass on to the next one. There's Futurepreneur and a couple other exceptions, but not, you'll kind of go on to the next thing, which is really angel or the VC. And you really only want to go there if you really have to. So that's kind of the steps to follow. So be systematic is my biggest advice for funding. So I think this will be the last slide. How to get funded. So as I just said in the last slide, be systematic, go through all the steps, move from the government funding to the angel to the VC. It's kind of like playing Monopoly. You can't just go all the way around the board. You have to kind of stop at your different places, pick up your houses or hotels before you get to the end. With each funder, really understand them. Take the time. If you have a meeting with, if you get to the point where you're actually meeting a VC, research his portfolio. What has he invested in before? What is he like? What is he not like? That information is not only important so you make sure you pick the right funder, but also when you sit down with him, you have something to talk about. Hey, I heard you invested in that company. What worked, what didn't work, and you actually can have a more advanced conversation. Put together a killer application pitch. Today we've seen some great pitches. It's not always the case, and sometimes people have great ideas. They put together a pitch the night before. It's kind of so-so. Unfortunately, if your pitch doesn't look that good, everything else we talked about can actually be, not look as good as well or does not go as well. Develop a win-win relationship. When you're speaking with investors, you shouldn't be speaking up to them, you shouldn't be speaking down to them, kind of face-to-face. This is a long-term relationship. You're going to have a dating-type relationship. It should be someone you want to hang out with, someone if you want to work with them, they want to hang out with you as well. So it really needs to be all about relationships. It's not a one-time, I met a guy, he's going to put $1 million, we're all set, I never need to talk to him again. It's the opposite. You're going to be with this person for a long, long time, maybe they'll put a little bit of money in as you go, but it's really about building that win-win relationship. And then move the deal to close. This is something I've seen some entrepreneurs that have been phenomenal in doing it. They kind of trigger it. They kind of make it happen. You need to hire this employee. You have this client you want to, get a product out to. So how do you actually go about getting the investor to put the money in now? Sometimes you need some of these triggers. Other times it happens more naturally. But, this is a bit of an art in terms of getting it. So thank you for listening to me. This is fundica.com if you want to go see more. It's a free resource. It's really what's allowed us to put together today. And the other side I was going to put up here, so I work at fundica.com. I also spend some time with R&D partners. So we work with companies to help them with the government funding and R&D tax credits. It's a different team than the Fundica team here, but it's something we do very well. We've done hundreds of millions of dollars in R&D tax credits. So if you have any questions on that, don't hesitate to reach out. So.
When it comes to putting a valuation on a particular proposal or a business, I guess the first thing that comes to my mind is to bring in a business evaluator, bring in a CBV, to do a complete professional analysis of what it is, like beholden to a certain kind of professional standard. That's my first instinct.
Right.
But I think that, I don't know how much that gets in the way of the vision of where something can go. So I just want to know, even before you go to get funding, from an angel investor or a VC, what do you do first?
So in terms of valuation, so it's a good question for me. I'm a CFA. I actually did valuations, worked at KPMG. I've done these kind of work before. When it comes to valuing a company, there's a few different ways to value it. Just so we kind of go very high level, look for some comparables. Companies like yours in the market, what do they look like? Another way, which is more assigned, well, another way to do it is also discounted cash flow. So what's your cash flow in the future? You discount it to today, what would that be worth? So those are kind of, I'm really just going very high level, breaking into two buckets, but looking at comparables or kind of looking at your own cash flow. If you bring in a business valuator, so say you brought me in, it's very hard for me to really do a very exact job because it's not that exact. So what I would do is I'd go out and find all these comparables, which for the most part I think you could do on your own. On the other side, there's this discounted cash flow. That's something you could bring someone to help you with, but I wouldn't spend too much money or time on this. I'd try to do it as best as possible on the comparables you could get. And when you do your financial model, it should just be a simple calculation in terms of, okay, what's it giving, what am I getting? But for the most part, it's going to be looking at comparables out there. What are people of my stage doing my kind of business getting in the market?
So basically, you're doing a model, and as you scale up, you have certain targets and expectations. And this is where you're going to be in 5 years.
Right.
If that's the timeline the investor wants to work with, that's what he's got to work with.
Yeah, I mean, if we're talking about angel investors or even VCs, we're talking at least 3 years, generally speaking. So they're kind of looking at longer term. So you kind of, what are those cash flows worth today is one valuation method. The other one is the comparables. The other thing I'd say is when you actually speak to investors, in a lot of cases, they're going to give you an idea. Listen, I've invested. You're not a $10 million company, but you're probably not a $2 million. So you start getting a bit of an idea. So
thanks.
Very, very inexact.
We're going to have to cut questions. If you want to if you have any questions for Mike, feel free to follow up after the road talk. So thanks a lot, Mike.
All right.
Give it up for Mike. So up next, we have another live pitch. So Pin Press. We're just setting them up. All right, give it up for Pin Press.
Do we have a clicker? Do we have a clicker? Or? I think we're waiting for some of the judges. They'd probably want to hear this. Should we talk through this? Good to see you too. Did you pitch as well? Good, yourself?
Yeah, I'm pretty good. You, Marco.
Nice to meet you. Awesome.
I want to talk to you afterwards because
this
is the second time I've actually seen this, and I missed you at Discovery because I was talking to some of the others. And
right, so you must have talked to my partner, Barrow. Yeah, sweet. Thank you. Should we just start?
Yeah.
Aren't these guys going to be judging me too, or how's it work? So I guess I'm going to start off with a little bit of a disadvantage. Only half the judges will be watching my pitch. All right, so I'm going to get started. Hi, my name is Asif, spelled as if. And yes, my parents speak perfect English, so they knew exactly what they were doing when they're naming me. So I'm thrilled to present to you Pin Press, 1,000 molds in one device. So manufacturers typically use a mold per every shape they're trying to produce. And this takes time to change. It takes time to change from producing one product of a certain shape to producing another product of a different shape. They call this changeover. Now, a line at Procter & Gamble does this twice a week, costs them 2 hours of downtime, and overall costs them $1 million a month. Now, I'm going to put down the mic for a second. But yes, I do carry this in my pocket at all times. And basically, I don't know, have you guys seen this toy before?
Yeah.
So the concept of our technology is very similar to this toy. By moving the pins up and down, we can change the shape of the surface. And now all of a sudden, you've removed the idea of 3D printing, and you've got this dynamic mold. And manufacturers can mass produce with this. So this is kind of a concept rendering of our technology. And this is not a new idea. This actual toy was patented in the 1890s, so it's a very, very old idea. And you know, this is a picture from Man of Steel where they're rendering a heart. So the concept is very old. And what you would see here is kind of a typical idea of what's going on. So you have let's say a plastic sheet. You put it into the system. The pins will change into a shape such as a square. You press down, mold it into that shape, reset it into the new shape, and then again repeat the process. All of a sudden, this two-hour process takes less than 15 seconds. So the way we were able to achieve this is by actually developing a new type of motor. And what our motor that we've developed is small and stackable. And for that reason, we can actually compress into a small space and create this dynamic mold. Now, we've patented this technology. And here's a prototype of how it looked about 6 months ago. Our newest prototype will actually be producing vacuum forming, be able to actually do shapes. And you can see we can move the pins, change the shape, and so forth. So our first investor was the University of Waterloo. And since then, we've won a few pitch competitions. And we actually participated in this program called Hacks, where we went to China and learned about the Chinese manufacturing market, as well as built our first prototypes. Just recently, we got into Johnson & Johnson's J-Labs program. We were the only non-pharmaceutical company that was put into that program. And we're working with Johnson & Johnson manufacturers to find out good applications for our technology in their lines. We're also working with smaller manufacturers to start figuring out, to start generating pre-sales. So our competition is the current tool and die market. They produce static products that cannot change shape. In contrast, our tools can actually change shape, and therefore takes that 2-3 hour process, makes it less than 15 seconds. I hope you remember it by now. I've said that a few times. All right, so our business model is a B2B OEM. We're selling these sort of modules that can be assembled together and made bigger and smaller based on the application of the manufacturer. Our initial target market is the soft plastic extrusions and soft materials. These are like thin films, basically low pressure, low temperature, paper and pulp packaging. Obviously, this is a very easy place for us to start because it has less requirements. As the technology matures, we plan to expand both into the more broad metal stamping injection molding market, which in Canada is a $13 billion market. In US and China combined, this tool and die market is valued at $550 billion. So why now? Well, manufacturers have gone away from mass producing a whole bunch of product and storing it to just-in-time manufacturing. Basically, they don't want to produce mass amounts of goods and store it. What they want to do is wait for an order. As order comes in, produce the product. Now, obviously, this leads to more changeover. This is where they're losing the time and losing potential income. So our solution helps solve that problem. And what this leads to is, imagine you have shoes. And instead of going to the store and trying out shoes, you can actually scan your foot in and go online and pick a shoe you want. And you know for a fact it'll fit your foot. But the best part of it is that it'll cost you the same price as the shoes you can buy in the mall. Why? Because of mass customization. And it no longer costs you that extra amount of money to get something custom for you. So our team is comprised of 4 nanotechnology engineers from the University of Waterloo. 3 of us finished our masters in electrical, chemical, and software engineering. And our 4th member actually worked at Procter & Gamble dealing with this problem in one of their manufacturing lines. So, we're PinPress, and we're right now looking for a little bit of an equity raise as well as partners to beta test our first product, which will be available in the next month and a half. And we're shaping the future. Thank you. Questions?
Rebecca.
Hi, sorry, can you go back and elaborate on your business model?
Sure. So, you know, I didn't want to go too much in detail in the actual thing, but so the type of model we're trying to do is very similar to Intel. So Intel has the Intel Inside model, where they're actually marketing their Pentium chips, right? No, well, not Pentium anymore, but their chips to the consumers, and now the consumers will only buy a laptop that has a Intel Inside. Similarly, we're actually talking to big companies like Johnson & Johnson, Procter & Gamble, some of these major manufacturing companies like Toyota, and we're telling them the value of our product because they're the ones that get the most benefit because their bottom line on their product reduces. So now what we're trying to do is we'll talk to them, they introduce us to their suppliers, and then we've created this module that can then integrate into their tools. So we're not trying to displace anybody, right? We're obviously trying to increase their market potential because now they can actually use it, create a more dynamic product, and so forth.
How do you make money?
How do we make money? We sell it. So we sell the actual modules themselves. Yeah.
And what's the cost of that?
So a typical line such as Procter & Gamble will spend $500,000 on one of these tools. Ours will cost possibly twice the price, but the ROI on this tool will be less than 3 months because of the amount of money they'll be saving from downtime.
Can you just give some examples of the type of products you're going to be producing with this technology?
Sure. So one of the really simple ones is packaging. So cardboard, all the different types of shapes, you ship everything everywhere, especially if you're buying stuff online. So these are the boxes that, you know, they want to reduce the amount of boxes. Actually, Amazon says it best, they want to reduce the amount of air they're shipping, right? And the way you do that is by reducing the actual box size. And so by our technology, you'd be able to create custom boxes very quickly for the specific products you're trying to sell.
Doesn't that take recycling properly where you would use the same box multiple times? Like now you've customized it to that shape, you can only use that one time, right? So isn't there a cost associated with that? Not being able to use the box 5 times or 10 times?
Yes, so I'm not 100% sure where you're going with that, but my interpretation. Basically what would happen is that you know, you use the box, a lot of consumers will actually just, you know, use the box, and recycling is a pretty good thing, right? You know, like, you just put it in the recycling box and you reuse the materials. So reuse of the box itself, I haven't run into that too much, but yes, that probably wouldn't be as much of an opportunity.
I recruit for plastic print and packaging. Okay. That's what I do. So I know that you have Husky, you'll have end users like Parpak or Polytanners or Amhill. They all have the number of different types of machinery that makes these products. There's a lot of different manufacturers. How would your technology fit in with each of these processes? It'll be a thermoform or injection mold or blow mold? Or
great question. Yeah, totally get it. So the biggest thing is, you know, our degree is in nanotechnology engineering. So we're really focused on miniaturizing the system. The reason we were able to get patents in this stuff is that because we realized that motors, in order to make it this small, was something that people haven't done yet. Because no one really considered this as an application. They were trying to use standard motors that didn't work. So when we designed the system, the biggest thing we took into consideration is how we can integrate it very easily in the pre-existing infrastructure. And so yes, because they're pins, because we're making them very tiny, they will plug into nicely with different applications. Obviously, some will require a lot more pressure, such as injection molding. We're not there yet, but we will be.
Okay, one last question. I know I saw some hands. Okay, I'm coming to you. Sorry, wait. Really, that's a rule. When you have a question, there's a microphone.
Everyone's getting excited here. Okay, that's good. How small we can make the pins? Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah, you're welcome. Okay, so basically right now they're about 5 millimeters, but that's only cost restraints, right? Because we are a startup and we're doing it based on the grant money that we have so far. In theory, we can get it to about 0.7 millimeters. I can comfortably say 1 millimeter. And that is the same size as a pixel on a TV screen. So we're talking about a very smooth surface. Now, even though the pins are small, like a 1 millimeter, you will still get that kind of gradient sort of like stairs, like a staircase type of effect. The way we compensate for that is we actually use a rubber layer, like a skin that will sit on top of the pins. And that kind of takes it from steps to kind of more of a ramp type of effect. And that will smoothen out the surface, and which is pretty good for most applications.
All right, well, thank you so much. Right on time. Okay.
So are you guys ready for the last pitch? Yeah? Come on, guys. Last pitch, Axis. Give it up. Axis.
Okay, thanks everyone. My name is Trung Pham. I'm the CEO of Axis. At Axis, we're a hardware company that designs practical window covering products. So first, I want to start off with a story. A couple years ago, my sister moved into her first home, and she already had 30 beautiful window shades installed. Now, she wanted to automate them, but she found that the process was very difficult and time-consuming. What she had to do is she had to remove all 30 shades, she had to retrofit them with motors, and then she had to reinstall them. So I never understood how something so simple could be so complicated. Now, this is not the first thing that shocked me. What shocked me was what she told me next. I asked her how much it cost to motorize it. She told me it cost her $400 per window just to get them motorized. So I asked, why was it so expensive? At Axis, we developed a system to motorize your existing window shades by controlling the beaded chains or cord loops of your shades. It's super easy to install, and it retails for less than half the cost of existing solutions. We call it the Axis Gear. Now with Gear, you're able to program when your shades should rise and fall. For example, you could have your shades rise when the sun rises to help you wake up in the morning. Once installed, you could still control your shades up close and personal using our on-device controls. The beautiful thing about Gear is that it can lift any shade regardless of size or weight. And with our mobile app, you're able to optimize your window shades and your room for energy efficiency or comfort. The Axis Gear will also integrate with other smart home devices such as the Nest thermostat. We like to say it's twice as powerful at half the cost. So we're playing in two very big markets. First, the commercial real estate market. Of the 5.6 million commercial real buildings in the US, we're going to be targeting the 780,000 with business building automation systems, or BAS. What this is this is essentially the Nest for commercial buildings. Of this, 200,000 already have lighting automation. So shade automation is a natural progression. We're also targeting the residential market. In the US, of the 114 million households, 45 million are already buying products to reduce energy usage. We'll be targeting the 16 million smart homes currently in the US. To understand how we're so affordable, we have to look at the value chain as well as the competition. The industry is dominated by the players Qmotion, Lutron, and Somfy. To give you an idea, Somfy is the largest player that earns €1 billion a year in annual revenues, and that's considering only 5% of shades are motorized each year. Somfy will create a motor for $50 and sell it to a fabricator for $100. Their job is to assemble the shades. They, in turn, will sell to a retailer or dealer for $200. So by the time it gets to your hands, it's $400. We're a little different. That same $50 motor, we do not sell to fabricators. We sell directly to the retailers or the dealers or the end consumer. At the same time, we still command a high margin. So we have a lot of traction to date. In North America alone, we're in talks with Target and Budget Blinds for distribution on the retail side. We're also in a beta program with BAS players Schneider Electric, Daintree Networks, which is a subsidiary of General Electric, and Alarm.com, who is in 2 million homes in the US alone. We have a letter of intent from European distributor BNC International, the largest distributor with 100 million in years in annual revenues. A similar situation in Europe or in Australia, where we received a letter of intent from Viewscape, Markalux, and Gale Pacific, who also earns $100 million a year in annual revenues. In terms of our business model, we plan on selling to international distributors, retailers, dealers, as well as directly online, with an average revenue per unit of $114. Of this, we expect to earn 58% gross margins. We expect our volumes to grow to well over 248,000 by the end of year three, which translates to 28 million in revenues by the end of year three. So some of our key milestones that we've already achieved include filing for 2 patents and setting our supply chain in China. At the end of this month, we'll be pushing out our beta units to our testers. We'll be wrapping up our design for manufacturing and starting our tooling process next month, and our units will be ready to ship by the end of this year. So we've raised quite a bit of funds to date. All funds are priced in US dollars. We've raised $380,000 through family and friends. I've invested over $130,000 myself, and we've received $90,000 in government grants. We are currently raising 1.5 million US, with 75% of the round already committed. The majority of the financing is for R&D, manufacturing, and scaling the team. And speaking about team, this is our great team. This is my second startup, actually. I have a background in finance with a CFA as well. Manu Menon handles our business development. He spent 2 years in investment banking in New York, as well as 2 years in private equity in Chicago. Mark Bishra is our CTO, with past experiences working at Kiwi Wearables as their lead hardware engineer, as well as Alan Chang, who is our industrial designer. He has UX, UI experience, as well as direct manufacturing experience in China. And that's it. Thank you.
Questions?
Does anyone on your team have any experience or connections into the interior design world?
So one of our investors does. So all of our investors in our current round is actually very strategic. So we have an investor that's in the retail marketing. We have investors in commercial real estate. And we have an investor in the A&D community, as you mentioned, the architect and design, as well as the dealer network.
I'm just curious, did you guys consider licensing it at some point, or was that never?
No.
What was the reason for that?
We're young, hungry, you want to build a brand.
No, don't do it.
I could repeat the question.
So I like the app and I like the touch as well. Have you guys considered a voice command as part of your product roadmap?
Not for the MVP. We kind of want to test what we have right now. We have a lot of ideas for the future, but I think we want to launch with a version that's good enough for consumers, get some feedback, and then iterate in future versions.
So where do you see yourself with potential competitors in the space? You know, you have Nest or other companies, and how do you plan on really, you know, if they get into the space, differentiating yourself from them?
I don't think Nest and the big dogs are actually interested in just building products around shade motorization, for example. I think a more logical competitor would be Somfy or one of the competitors I mentioned. I think with Nest, they want to be the dominant platform. So they want to be the guys that we integrate with, and which we do. So I don't think Nest is a concern. I think over time, these large players with products and platforms such as Nest, building out a security system, building out thermostat and a smoke protector, I think they'll want to acquire other companies with great products to build that moat around their platform as well.
Awesome.
Thank you.
The last question? Yeah. Sorry. Sorry.
I noticed that all your clientele bases are overseas. Kudos to you. But why not in Canada? What was the thought around it? Or do you have...
Oh, no, we do. So in Canada, we are talking... Well, Canada, we're talking with Budget Blinds. I would say more North America. Canada is not too strong of a market. What we're doing in Canada is building a dealer network. So we're building relationships with the architect and design community, and they'll be able to push it to commercial properties as well as the residential properties. Nothing in the retail space specifically in Canada, though. Online in Canada, majority is in the States.
Hi, yes. How's it going?
Hi.
Ian Hersey. We met at TELUS, remember?
Yes. How's it going?
Yeah, okay. We've been playing phone tag.
Yes.
My cousins are, for many years, one of the biggest distributors of drapery parts, manufacturers, stamps, screws, all that stuff. Major Velcro distributor in the States. So if you want my help, I'll help you.
Okay, great. I will. We'll talk after.
Different kind of question, but thank you. All right, well, thanks a lot.
Thank
great
you.
Pitch. All right, so who here has a phone? Raise your hand. Come on, I know, I saw you all texting. All right, great. So the next segment, before we announce the actual Fandika Roadshow winner, we're gonna get the Founder Institute Toronto chapter cohort pitch you for 3 minutes. And at the end, we're gonna get every one of you guys to play the judging role that these guys have been playing all day. And we'll get to, we'll ask you to also pick your best Founders Institute pitch. They'll get $250, not $250 in cash prize. Before we do that, we have those feedback forms. We want to keep on improving the Funding Roadshow, so we're gonna go through the rows and distribute them. Please fill them up. Tell us what we could change, what we can improve, what you like, what you didn't like. There's a question from the audience. Yes. Comment? We will send it to you online, but you have to promise. Exactly, we'll send it to you online. You have to promise to actually fill it up. But for the people that want to fill it up, we'll just distribute it. I know that you're a very advanced technology guy, but some people actually like pen and paper. I love pen and paper. And yeah, okay, so without further ado, let me introduce you Michael Shepherd, who is the semester president of the Founder Institute Toronto chapter, and he'll also be introducing you to the program and to the other pitches. But we will be actually distributing them, the feedback form, while we do the pitches. So please fill them up and then return them to us at the end. Thank you so much. So we're gonna go actually through, sorry, Michael. The quicker you guys go through your feedback form, the easier it is. Pen? Yeah, I'm collecting. All right, guys. All of you guys have pens? No? Pens. And it's a nice Funding Roadshow pen, too. All right. Richard, let's play some music. Right? Have other paper. Do you have pen? 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 Thank you guys for completing the forms. Pass along the forms. Thank you. All right, we'll be coming with pens. Just the feedback form? Of course. Oh wow, look at you. So for the rest of you guys, we'll be sending it to you online as well. So thank you so much for filling it up. And the judges will also get another feedback form online. Oh la la. So Mike is going through and collecting the feedback forms. All right. So we'll just bring more people for the five pitches as we're waiting. All right, one more minute, guys. Teresa Larico was the woman in tech, Fireside Chat. Up. All right. Okay, guys, while we're waiting, let's do the wave. We'll start with you in the back. Woo! Wave, wave, wave. Everyone wave. This is getting very, very slow. No one's waving. Woo! Okay, see, I like that. Yes. And guys, there's gonna be an evening networking session at Mercado from 5:30 to 7. All right. For the people that we ran out for feedback forms, we're going to be sending it to you. I'm going to kick it off.
Are you going to force me to stand there?
Okay. No. All right, Mike? We're good? All right. So please give it up for Michael Shepherd and the Founders Institute cohort. Give it up.
Thank you very much. I'm Michael Shepherd. I'm thrilled to be here with you tonight. We have got an outstanding roster of recent grads from Founder Institute, and you're going to see some lightning fast presentations. These guys know the timing. We're going to give them a hard 3 minutes, and then that's it. They are done at that point. We're competing for a $250 prize, and I want to briefly mention about Founders Institute. You have an amazing opportunity with this program. This is the largest and fastest growing startup idea stage incubator in the world. We've got 4,400 mentors around the world. These are people that you see regularly on TV and other major executives. And as well, we have an amazing team in Toronto. Toronto has just led the largest group of companies. We put 68 companies that started into the program back in January. So the first company we're going to show you is Turgut. He's with Vested in You. Let's give him a round of applause.
Test.
Okay. Hi, everyone. It's funny that I am presenting a company on wellness and health, and I am sick today myself. My name is Turgut. I am the CEO and the data scientist of the company called Vested in You. Today, I'm going to convince you that I am actually a very healthy guy. It took me 10 years to get to my first major soccer competition win. 2 years to be the second fastest swimmer in 12 schools, and 1.5 years to win my first gold medal in Dragon Boat Races B Division in Ontario. What's interesting about the last two is that I received professional help, guidance, and training from professional people to get to my goals much, much faster. But despite all those, I lost my track on getting much more fit, and I decided to look for options. Wasting all the money in the gyms, not going anytime. Actually, $25 billion is being spent annually on gym and health memberships. 67% of those are never being used. It means I am not alone, even in this room. So when I decided to look for a personal trainer, I quickly find that it was so expensive to work with a personal trainer, especially with big box gyms like Good Life, where it's so hard to get to
find the person trainer you need, and they just keep the lots of most of the revenue to themselves. That person trainers get very tiny fraction, as least as 20%. And there is no such an easy way that exists to book a person trainer online. That's why we are trying to build this platform to help connect the person trainers with the clients at their convenience, like at any location they want, at any time they need. It's flexible and convenient for the clients. While the clients, like me, save money, person trainers get to make more money, as we are not a good life and we are not going to take that much cut into their profits. In terms of market validation, we already have 19 paying customers through the manual process we have set in, and we have 150 plus signups on our platform already. Just in three simple steps, you can search, review, and book your personal trainer on three simple steps on our platform. It's so hard to talk to Mike. I have been asked a lot of questions about how do you keep those personal trainers on your platform once they meet and they have the connection already. We have went out and interviewed so many personal trainers and clients to understand what their pain points are, and they get to spend so much time and effort on getting handle of the payments and the scheduling, as well as the person workout database, where they send out the workout database and they have to keep track of it through paper. There's a huge room in Good Life Gyms where they keep all the track of the paperwork through old style. The business model is simple. We only take 10% transaction fee on the personal trainer. We have few competitors. And we have an amazing team. This is something that I'm very proud of. And we have some great stories. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Turgut. Next up, we have Dion from Hijinx.
Hello. I'm excited about this $250,000. This is really cool. Okay, hi everyone, my name is Dion, and I'd like to introduce you to my company, Hijinx, the platform that allows you to research and book incredible life experiences easily. What do I mean by a life experience? Well, that could be a zipline adventure, trampoline dodgeball with your colleagues at work, or even a cooking class. I want to step back and tell you a little bit about myself first. That is me, and I have spent the last 12 years in the corporate world. I grew from a team of one to a team of 400, and recently made the decision to follow my passion and go after life experiences and adventure. I truly believe that an experience is more important in life than a thing. So I want to compare the two. On the left is the way you buy an experience, or sorry, a thing today. If you want to buy a new toaster, you can go to Amazon and click, and it's on the way to your house the next day. If you want to buy an experience, it's a lot more challenging. I recently booked an escape room experience for my son's birthday party. And this is essentially a room which they lock you in, you solve a series of puzzles to escape. And to do that, I went to Google and I went from site to site to site to try and find the right thing. It took a long time. And we actually made it. That smile on my face doesn't tell the whole story though, because it actually took three times as long to find and book the escape room than we actually spent trapped in the room itself. So the solution is Hijinx, where you can search and browse by category and location, take the benefit of integrated ratings and reviews, pay online, and split the payment with friends, which helps us grow our user base efficiently. This is a snapshot of the site literally from earlier this week, and we're planning a launch next month. The revenue model is simple. The customer books and pays in full. Then we pass the payment, less a commission and payment fees on to the provider after the experience is enjoyed. From a competition perspective, there's a plethora of companies today that are providing a subset or niche offering of experiences. Things like Groupon and WagJag, which are daily discount, daily deal sites, and then many sites that are focused on providing an experience as a gift. My plan is to focus on providing a comprehensive listing of every experience in the local market to differentiate ourselves. Why now? There's over 100 million millennials in North America. 78% of them have said they'd rather spend their money on experiences than things, and their consumer spending is more than doubling in the next 4 years. The go-to-market strategy is to focus first on Toronto,
prove the model out, and then expand into the US and follow a city-by-city rollout strategy. I have a fantastic team in place. Robert, my lead developer, and I are working full-time right now building out the platform, and I have advisors with experience building online hotel booking sites and in the Toronto tech community. And from a funding perspective, today I'm bootstrapping to build the prototype, prove the model out, before moving on to new markets and looking for funding to support that. That is Hijinx, and I'm looking forward to making it just as easy to purchase an experience online as it is to purchase a thing. Thank you.
Thank you, Dion. Up next, we have Brian from ConnectGood.
Thank you. All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Brian Sikransky. I'm the founder of ConnectGood. ConnectGood is a SaaS application that delivers social good as a service. Basically, what it does is it allows sales reps and entrepreneurs to thank, reward, motivate, and inspire their customers by providing them with charitable donation to their social cause of choice. And the end effect is to accelerate sales. I came up with this idea after spending 20 years in B2B sales, and it's really challenging. Over my career, I sold over $12 million, but I had to fight for every dollar. So what I'm trying to do is create an application that can help salespeople sell faster and in a way that has a social good aspect to it, because B2B sales is really challenging. One of the big challenges in my target market, which is small, medium-sized software companies, is that's 99% of the market, but they compete against giants. They compete against Salesforce, Microsoft, and Oracle, and it's really hard to compete against those companies. So what do they do today? They give them mouse pads, pens, and gift cards. That's the big solution to try to motivate your customers, incentivize them, inspire them to buy more, and it doesn't work. It's miserable. And part of the reason they do stuff like this is there's a lot of rules and regulations around trying to prevent corruption and bribery. So software companies go to the extreme and they give their customers stuff that has no value and the customers don't want. This is the alternative, ConnectGood. So what ConnectGood does basically is it allows a sales rep to send a customer a charitable donation and allow the customer to pick where to send that donation. They pick the charity, they pick their cause. Think Echo Age for business. That's a good analogy to think of. And this works for three big reasons. One, it's leveraging something called pro-social behavior. When the amount is below $200, people actually prefer to give it to somebody else. They get a better feeling, they feel better about it than to receive something for themselves. The other key aspect to understand is there's a charitable taxable benefit to doing this. So it's actually less costly than using promo items or gift cards. The platform is a complete service. It automates the entire process from the charitable donation to the tax receipting. It's a subscription-based service. The wonderful thing about it is most of my customers will be able to expense it. Going to move ahead. So we have some early traction. Lots of people have started to pre-register. The service is not available, but it will be available in about 6 weeks. Board of Advisors is absolutely phenomenal. I've got guys on the board who have over 100 years combined experience. So ConnectGood is solving pervasive business problems, helping sales reps and companies accelerate their sales, and it does it in an innovative way that actually has a social good aspect to it. That's ConnectGood. Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. Up next, we have Bobby from Parlay.
New mic, just want to make sure it works.
Okay. So Parlay is a student engagement platform that redefines how educators inspire meaningful and global class discussions. Is there a solution to the Syrian refugee crisis? That's a great question or debate for a class of students in Toronto and also in Istanbul. But what if they could have that conversation together and the whole thing was quarterbacked by a language API? What if you could have that conversation 1,000 times in 1,000 classrooms all over the world and then 1,000 conversations just like it? This is the future of discussion in a liberal education, and we're building it. So how will we change online discussions? Currently, teachers are likely to get 50% engagement. Conversations are confined to the class, they're difficult to measure, and it's time-consuming to create. We're going to introduce proven pedagogy, gamified contribution, and globally connected discussions to elicit full engagement, broadened perspectives, easily measured participation, and effortless prompt creation. How are we going to do that? The Parlay toolkit will provide pre-configured prompt styles that are easy to create, and they'll use advanced research-backed techniques like peer and self-assessment to elicit critical thinking, and then we'll use natural language processing to measure and guide student learning outcomes. Next, students will accumulate Parlay points for a range of value-added activities such as those you see above. They'll receive awards and accolades, which they can use for bragging rights or, of course, marks, and teachers will have a way to effortlessly measure both the quality and quantity of student participation. Finally, the Parlay universe will allow teachers to access to a global community where they can discover prompts, where they can connect with similar educators, and they can combine their discussions to really break down the walls of the classroom. Of course, there are discussion platforms out there. Most of them exist in full LMS systems, and they're usually pretty boring. Blackboard's a great example. And there's a couple other point solutions which we think are comparable to Parlay. I don't want to belabor the point here or get too deep into it, but effectively, the three value-added features I just discussed, many prompts, styles, gamification, and connected discussions are what are also our competitive differentiators versus these two. Our target market is the 5,000 plus independent schools internationally. Why the independents? Because they're global, they have advanced IT programs, they have forward-thinking academics, they have independent purchasing decisions, they're trendsetters, and of course, they have budgets. We have early traction at 7 of the top independent schools in Canada who have either agreed to be part of our test market or have also signed an LOI. Testing is going to be 10 to 15 schools in September 2016 school year. We're going to really get the product right. Then we're going to do a land grab strategy and get between 100 and 500 schools for the 2017 version 1 rollout, and then we'll charge our first SaaS revenues in 2018. We have a world-class board of advisors. Everyone has 20 plus years experience in their respective fields and or in education. I'm myself, founder and CEO. I'm a sales engineer at a company in Toronto. We're working with a development company out of Waterloo, a team of four, to build the MVP. And we're in the final stages of interviewing a very senior CTO. Why me? Finally, I have built this idea in the last 6 months. I started on Post-it notes, and now I'm here today. I work 60 hours a week. I really care about this idea. It's sort of like my life's calling. I'm not motivated by personal financial gain. I'll outwork anyone. I'll out-innovate everyone because this matters so much to me, and I'm doing it for the right reasons. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Up next, we have Aga from Cubesters.
Hello. My name is Agabari. I'm a founder and CEO of Cubesters. I've been in the music industry for over 10 years in a variety of roles, including voting member for the Grammys since 2012. Music industry, as messed up as it is, it's a huge and growing industry, and it's passing $50 billion by 2018. Traditionally, it's been dominated by major music labels, but what happened for the first time last year was that independent music labels and artists have been responsible to generating the majority of the revenue. And the reason is simple. On the left is what you needed to make music in the beginning of a century. What you need now is drastically different. Stronger and cheaper technology has made the process of making and sharing music much easier and cheaper, and because of that, there are many players in the industry. Streaming services proved to be the industry's answer to the growth of the music industry and musicians, but they have many, many different problems. Financially, in the best case scenario, you make less than $3,000 out of the 43 million plays of your Grammy-winning song. another problem with streaming services is that they're using compressed songs in the format of MP3, which is smaller in size and takes less space, but the quality is lower. With that kind of an attitude, we are ignoring a wide range of music listeners and music producers and music fans who are interested in high-quality music. The benefits of high-quality uncompressed music is that the quality is amazing, but there is a downside to it, which is takes a larger space. What we're doing in Cubesters is we're building a direct interaction on both sides of the market, musicians and fans, which is based on high-quality content. Artists submit a music, and the music has to get approved for the high quality of it, and then it gets tagged and stored in a blockchain database. What the blockchain database gives us is the ability to real-time and direct access to interactions history, traceability based on recorded identification, and give trade, exchange, license, and collaboration ability between users. Users then can stream it for free or download and buy a share in that song. They can pay as much as they want. The minimum is set by the musicians. This is an example. It works much better when animated, but I try to explain it. If a song is priced at 99 cents, a 99 cents purchase will get you one song and one share, which is the blue line. The user who has a share in the song will earn money as for the future sales of the song, and the value of a song also goes higher based on the number of sales of that song. Once a song is valued, we put them in our monthly newsletter as like a catalog and send it to all our members and users. We want musicians to create more and fans to promote more and both to benefit from it. Currently, we have musicians from 25 countries, including a Grammy winner artist. We have a great team, a full stack developer, great music industry advisory board, and great tech and business advisory board. We already launched a landing page. We are aiming for MVP in July and full launch in March 2017. We are a lean startup, registration fee, service fee, and advertisement is our revenue model. And what sets us apart from our competitors is our focus on high quality content, gamification of industry, and leveraging our multiplicative social media tactics to create credibility.
And that's Aga from Cubesters.
Thank you so much.
Up next is Michael Shepherd with Insurables.
Oh, wait, we can skip the opening part. I've already introduced myself. I am thrilled to be talking to you about insurance today. Now, stay with me. You're going to love this by the end. So, what I found in starting several companies is that it's absolutely crazy how much I had to pay for my employees to get health benefit plans for them. So Insurables is out to end the completely unfair premiums that startups have to pay for their health insurance. So 67% of small businesses don't have benefits at all, while 77% of employees would not work for a company without that. So it's going to make it hard to really hire these people. This is a 70% of Canadian employees, right, are actually working for small business, which we're focusing on. This is a $56 billion industry in Canada. So if we were to go out as a typical insurance brokerage, we'd have a very similar cost structure. But we can notice the sales commissions are a huge chunk of the premiums that you pay. So we're going to get rid of those. We have an internal non-commissioned sales team providing all our service. And then there's lots of other areas where this is not a direct claims cost. So we actually have some IP innovation in these areas for bringing these costs down, including claim pre-screening and our online API. So if we put all that together, we can get startups a 32% savings on their group health benefit plans. And we have zero penalty for employees that have just a small company. We grow with the companies and we can change our plans as they come. So let's look at a real example here. This is Claire. We can bring her benefits down to $3,600. And with an upgraded plan, we can actually take her WSIB cost to the employer down to zero. So we charge an 8% fee on all the claims paid, which is much lower than a 50% markup that a mainline carrier is going to charge you for something simple like a dental cleaning. We've got a lot of advantages against the other traditional insurance, the brokers, and the administrative companies out there. So we have beautiful, clear plans. You can get your plan down to one page and have everyone in your company understand exactly what they get, and they won't have any confusion about whether or not their claims are going to be paid. So We've got some detailed numbers. I'd love to talk with you more about this on how we can save you 33% to 41%, right, as the company grows through its different phases. So we have several completely unfair advantages. Our team has worked in every part of the value chain, and as these plans grow, right, we can grow with your company, right? The plans can be customized per employee, which is something you can't get in the market right now. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Michael. And our last pitch is Makita from Stock Render.
Hi there. Oh no. It happens, I guess. We can do two slides. I don't care. Just want to get you guys out of here, right? That's what everyone is excited about. But yeah, so what do we do? So 2 years ago, I had a problem. I had grown the size of my stock investment portfolio to $50,000, but I was spending more and more time doing research and less time actually investing. So I found the hedge fund I was working for had a very similar problem. They were doing a lot of research, and it was hard for them to find the good stocks that were out there. So I started Stock Render. Now, we build financial analysis tools and data feeds for hedge funds, and we take those same feeds and we sell them to regular active investors like myself. Now, generally what investors want to see are six things before they make a decision. And these six things are freely available online. You can see them anywhere. But the problem is, when you go in there, they look like that. And now there's great information up there. There's 20 pages of information, but you're going to have to sift through that to find those things, right? And so a time waster, and most of that information, about 90% of it, is basically useless to the average investor. Because investors want to execute specific strategies, and they want to look for specific data points that they use for those strategies. Now, what's our solution? So down here on the bottom, you see our solution. One click, you're always there. You come back every time you see what you want to see. With the competitor's website, you're going to have to waste 4.5 minutes just to see the same information that we're showing on our screen up there. And that's a huge time saving. Now, especially when you're comparing multiple stocks and you're trying to look at different fundamentals, you're going to start writing stuff down. You're going to have to start multiple tabs. So basically what's going to happen is you're going to make a mistake. You might forget something. And you're not going to be as great as an investor as you should be. Now, what's the market for financial data services? In the U.S., it's around $26.5 billion. That's globally. And the U.S., it's about $7.4 billion. And that's growing at almost 5% each year for the next 5 years. Now, just for price data feeds alone, there's $401 million being spent on that just in the U.S. for investors like myself, not including banks. Now, the competition out there, right now we're competing with online finance websites, but they don't offer the upgradability, the customization, and they have a bunch of annoying ads in the way. Now, as we grow and as we add more features, we're going to start competing with companies like Bloomberg. Now, someone here is a really big fan of Bloomberg, but the problem is that the terminal costs $24,000 a year to use. We're going to have that at a much lower price point. And we're also going to have a much more functional UI. To use Bloomberg properly, you need to buy their proprietary keyboard, and you need to basically memorize a page of prompts to have the best functionality. You don't need that with us. Now, what's our business model? Essentially, hedge funds pay us $500 a month per user to access everything. And active investors start with something really basic, but they can upgrade to the hedge fund level if they so choose. And the reason we have a two-sided model is because the investing and the hedge fund community are very small, and they talk. They talk a lot. So once hedge funds sign up, more active investors will be interested. And once more investors sign up, hedge funds are going to hear about us. Now, traction. We're actually working with two hedge funds, each of them over $100 million in assets. And they're really interested, and they've asked us to build apps for them specifically. We also have 350 active investors sign up, such as myself. And we're also a Mars Venture Services company. And we'll be graduating Founder Institute in the next week. So skipping the timeline, basically Stock Render builds tools for hedge funds and also sells them to investors. We're launching September 1st. And we're working with hedge funds to help us do it. Thank you.
So, guys, take out your phones. Let's start voting. So you need to text this number, 587-409-6630.
You just need to text them the number of your favorite Founders Institute pitch once. It will not work more than once, but you can get your family and friends to actually text for you. So we'll wait. We'll do 2 minutes of voting. While we're doing the 2 minutes of voting, if you guys have any questions for the Founders Institute,
we can take questions for Founder Institute itself, if anyone has any questions about joining up, or for any of the pitchers tonight.
All right, just 1 more minute left, guys. I think Vested in You, BizPros, and Connect Good also deserve votes, guys. You can vote for yourselves too, guys. That's not wrong. It's called hashtag hustle. All right. Almost half a minute. And then we'll announce the actual Fundica Roadshow winner. All right. 10 more seconds. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, congratulations. Hijinks, come out.
Come on up, Hijinks.
Congratulations. We're just going to do if you want to say a quick word.
Okay. Just thanks very much. It's an honor to be working with a great cohort at Founder Institute, and looking forward to connecting with the community as we go forward. And the balloons are fantastic.
We're just going to do a nice photo offering.
Okay. And then this $250,000 check, right?
Yeah.
It was funny the first time. I get it.
Money.
Yes, okay. Yeah. Cool.
All right. Okay. So, there we go. Oh, I guess. No glasses. All right. Okay, congratulations.
Let's give him a big round of applause.
Exactly. Can we have the whole Founders Institute for a photo, please?
Let's give a round of applause for all of our pitchers today.
All right. So if I can get everyone in the room to come out, to go back in the back, we're going to have a nice photo op when we're going to announce the winner. So go to the back, guys. It's all good. Everyone in the back, no sides. All right. Okay, so thank you all for coming out today. Before I announce the winner, we're just going to say a big thank you to all of our, you know, volunteers, all of you guys, all of the funders, all of the speakers, all of the entrepreneurs that are coming out and the pitches. You guys did a really good job. Please, you know, applause for yourselves. So thank you so much. I'd also like to thank my team for helping and making this a success. None of this would be possible without you guys. You guys have met, you know, Katie, Shona, Dana, Mike, Richard, and there's many more people, you know, in Montreal. So I said this was our 12th stop, but it's not a 12th stop. It's just our 10th stop. We just have one more in Waterloo and then one in San Francisco. So we're about to announce the winner. So drum roll. And the winner is Sampler. Congratulations. Congratulations. There you go. So I wish, but Mike really likes this trophy. So let's just get a photo op. And after we do that, pictures. All right. So any words for aspiring entrepreneurs?
I mean, just keep going, guys. Like, I came here today, and like I said at the end of my pitch, I was incredibly tired. And there's always these little wins that really push you up. And I think that thank you for hosting this, because it's definitely going to give me another push.
Great. Fantastic to hear. So thank you all for coming. And we want a group picture. So please, everyone, stand up. Go as far as possible in the back. We're gonna do this. We do this in every stop, so. And then there's networking at Mercado, so. Yeah, I'll take one. All right, team, go. Back, Mike. All the entrepreneurs. Rich, you're gonna be in the pick. All right. Okay. Squeeze in. Yeah, come closer to each other.